Okay, so yes, I will start. Well, so in the last time I explained that by applying wall crossing in the derived category, there is a product expansion formula of the generating series of stable pair invariants. So let me call that X is smooth projective CYSV. And starting from here, we can define invariant counting curves that is called a stable pair invariant that was Pn beta in Z. And we considered generating sheets counting when this is a virtual number of stable pairs. Whose fundamental homologous coincides with beta, and homomorphic Euler characteristic of F is n. And yes, as I thought, so this is something like counting pair of curves and points on it. And by considering its generating sheets, so I told that there is a product expansion formula of this series that is given by the product of exponential of so-called large N invariant and also contribution from some large L invariant. And so as I told yesterday, so this is something like virtual number of one-dimensional semi-stable sheaves. And this is invariant counting more exotic object, and that is counting 13 stable objects in derived category that has 13 safe dual property. Yes, geometrically speaking, so the left-hand side is counting some pair of curves and points. So this is Pn beta, and this is counting curves and points, or so on. And on the other hand, well, this invariant counts, this is something like pair of curves and like vector bundle on it, so it might be some. And so geometrically, well, these are somehow not the same. And the error term is described in terms of 13 exotic object that is counting 13 objects in the derived category. That may not be written as 13 nice pair or so on. But anyway, so yesterday I gave a definition of this invariant. So that is, I gave explicit stability conditions which defines the moduli space, which defines this invariant. And I postponed the definition of this invariant. So roughly speaking, this large N invariant is defined by the usual Donaldson-Thomas invariant that is written as dt omega 0, 0, beta n. So 0, 0, beta n is a chain character of one-dimensional sheaf. But in the first lecture, I defined the Donaldson-Thomas invariant when there is no strictly semi-stable sheaf. That is, when omega is ample, and V is a numerical class, and I gave a definition of dt invariant when there is no strictly semi-stable sheaf. That is, we discussed that the moduli stacks of stable objects and moduli stacks of semi-stable objects, semi-stable sheaves. And if these moduli stacks are the same, then the coarse moduli space of this moduli space, moduli stack, is indeed becomes projective scheme. And if this is equal, then this was defined as the integration of the batch fundamental class or integration of the so-called parent function. So when this is when, this is equality. So today's goal is to define the invariant, the Nelson-Thomas invariant, when this condition is not satisfied. And in that case, at this moment, there is no interpretation of such invariant using Bourdieu fundamental class. But we can define such invariant using parent function. So today's goal is define DT invariant, which current strict semi, which also contain strict semi-stable sheaves, without condition, without stable equal semi-stable condition. Yes, indeed, for the definition of this counting one-dimensional semi-stable sheaves, it may not be necessary true that these two modular stacks are the same. So indeed, there might be some strictly semi-stable sheaves. So in this definition, this possibility may happen. For example, you can just take the smooth curve inside X, and you can take the direct sum of its structure sheaf. Then it is, of course, one-dimensional semi-stable sheaf, and it also contributes to this invariant. And however, such sheaf is not stable. In particular, so there are something non-trivial automorphism. And if there is some, like, for example, you consider, like, curve, and take direct sum of the structure sheaf, well, in that case, it is contained in here, but not contained in here. And indeed, the automorphism group of this sheaf is GL2C. And we have to define the invariant which also affects affects such automorphism group. Okay, so first I will so far we have I have postponed about the definition of the parent function, so here I define it. So indeed he defined it on any scheme, complex scheme, but here I define it on some stack of coherent sieves on Calabrian threefold. So this is nothing but where this is a direct generalization. But so anyway, so let's consider the stack, cof x. So this is a stack of, so this is a very big stack. This is parameterized of the object, of the coherent sieves on Calabrian threefold x. So this is a very big stack because we didn't take any stability on it. So it is, in particular, not finite type. It is locally of finite type, but not finite type. But the stack which we considered in here are shown to be open substacks of this very big stack. That is open, and this is open. And on this stack, there is some special property of the local behavior. I mean, indeed, it is known that, yeah, it is easy to see that if some scheme is written as a critical locus for some function, then we can easily construct symmetric perfect obstruction theory. And the converse is not true, but in this case, it is always true. That is, so this is a result by Joyce and his collaborators that for any point in this stack, closed point, so there is a certain smooth map from some scheme. So this is a scheme. That sends P prime to P. And this is a smooth map, smooth morphism. And also there is a closed embedding of U into some other scheme. So this is a smooth scheme. And a regular function on V such that this U is written as a critical locus of this function. So this is a special property for the moduli theory on Calabi-Yau threefold. And if you consider other varieties, if you consider if you take X to be non-Calabi-Yau or Calabi-Yau, but it is higher dimensional, then this property is not true. Yes, and it is also by taking, by shrinking V if necessary, we can also take this one to be contained in V0 to be the V-image of 0. And so classically, if there is some function on smooth scheme, then there is naturally associated to the so-called Seehoff vanishing cycles. So it is defined in as a certain object in the derived category of constructive sheaves on U, and it is given in the following way. So this is Seehoff vanishing cycles. Is where first I have a map from V to C, and the pre-image of 0 is given by V0, and the complement of C, the complement of 0 is just C star, and let's take the fiber product here, and I'm taking the universal covering space. And take again the fiber product. So let's take the its composition by J. So then we can define some objects like this. I mean, so let's define IF to be the cone of the map from, so by adjunction, there is a natural map, QV. So QV is a constant sheaf on V. And we take the pullback of the constant sheaf to here and then push forward to here. and then shift of something. It lies in the derived category of constructive sheaf on V0, or even in on U. It is indeed supported on U. So this is called the sheaf of vanishing cycles. And on Friday, I will use this vanishing cycle sheaf to discuss about Kobachmann buffer invariant. But anyway, for the purpose of defining parent function, it is not just enough to think about the Euler number at each point. That is, let's define new P, so P is the given point over here. So this is defined by minus 1, relative dimension of pi. So pi is a smooth map, so the relative dimension makes sense. And minus 1, and Euler number. So if you take it with, I'm sorry, so I forget about taking with station to V0. Right, if you take the system of this sheaf to prime, well, this is an object in the derived category of a vector space, so you can just take its Euler number. So this is a very defined, so this is an integer. And we can see that, well, this value is independent of several choices, like the choice of this smooth chart U and smooth scheme V and the function F. In this way, we have the map that is new from stack integer, so that is a locally constructive function. And this is called parent function. So, as I told in the first lecture, the usual Donaldson-Thomas invariant is, on one hand, it is given by the integration of the two-dimensional virtual fundamental class, and on the other hand, it is written by the integration of the parent function. So, if I rephrase that statement, that is, if there is no strictly semi-stable sheaves, then, and the coarse moduli space was denoted by m omega v, so this was just a C-star job. So because this is a C-star job, constructive function on here can be naturally interpreted as constructive function on here because the set of geometric points are the same. And so this was the result by Behrendt. Omega V is given by the integration of the constructive function. So anyway, we can also define the parent function on this stack. So as I told, well, these are the open substacks of the stack group of the coherent sieves on X, and by restricting this constructive function to here, we have the well-defined constructive function on this stack. So naively speaking, we may want to define the Thomas invariant which do not satisfy this condition as something like if there is some strict symmetry received, then naively speaking, we want to define like the integration of the Bellman function restricted to here. But this naive idea does not make sense because, so here, so this is a weighted Euler number with respect to this constructive function. But in order to make this definition, make sense, we need to know the notion of the Euler number of Artin-Stack. So these are just Artin-Stack and not the Wiener-Manifold stack. So this means that stabilizer groups are not finite group. For example, as I described here, so this might appear as a stabilizer group. So I mean, so the issue about the issue on this naive definition is that even this is not well defined. I mean, the Euler number of Artin stack does not make sense. Right, for example, easy example of Artin stack is given by quotient stack. That is, if we consider some variety and which admits action of like G of NC. Yes, indeed, this kind of stack is very important in thinking about this stack. Indeed, this modular stack is, I will talk later, but this modular stack is stratified in this kind of stack, quotient stack. But anyway, so why is a certain quasi-projective variety and which admits action of GFN? So naive attempt to try to define this Euler number might be something like Euler number of Y and quotient of Euler number of Y by the Euler number of the group GFN, but this is always zero, so this one does not make sense. And on the other hand, yes, I will talk later, but if you replace Euler number by the like Poincaré polynomial, then this quotient doesn't make sense. The problem is that we're taking the certain limit of the variable of the Poincaré polynomial. Does not make sense. And surprising idea by Dominic Joyce is that, well, this one does not make sense because of this issue. But instead, if we replace this stack as a certain logarithm in some algebra that is called motoric Hopf algebra, then this integration makes sense. So this is due to press this stack. By certain logarithm of this one, or it's not precise, we should say something like logarithm of something like this, omega SSV, where the like reduced Hilbert polynomial is fixed. So yes, now I'm going to explain what this means. And so this logarithm is taken in the so-called Motivic Hopf algebra. Motif equal algebra. So I'm going to define it now.
Yeah, but
where is it? Huh? There is an
error.
What's Okay, so yes, I define this notion of motif equal whole algebra. So there exists several versions of this definition, but and I will here this definition is something where the definition which does not involve not so many deletions. So on the vector space, I define Hx as a Q vector space generated by symbols like this. Module of some deletions. So here, this is Artin stack of finite type. And for some technical reason, I have to assume that Y has some more strong property of stabilizers. You know, so stack is something like space together with the automorphisms together with the information of the automorphisms at each point, and assume that for any closed point, the automorphism group is a fine algebraic group. Of course, this is one of the examples of such Artin stack. That is, if you take this quotient stack, then every automorphism is a closed subgroup of GLN. So this is Artin stack with, so that each subgroup is a finite, it's a fine algebraic group. And the deviation is defined by similar to the definition of the quotientic ring of varieties, which appears in, for example, like just in the theory of motivic integrations. The division is that for any closed substack, we have this Caesar division that is y to of x equivalent to set to of x plus y minus z to of x. No, I didn't assume any singularity here.
Sorry?
I didn't assume anything. So you mean singularity of Y?
No,
or no? There's no assumption. There's no assumption. That is all assumption. Okay, so yes, this motif equal algebra is that where there is certain natural product structure on this Q vector space. Of course, this is very big vector space. This is infinite dimensional vector space. But well, still there is nice product structure on here. So in order to define the product structure on here, we need to introduce some other stack that is a stack of short exact sequence. Highlight X to be the stack of short exact sequence of coherent sieves. In cof x. Well, set theoretically each quote point corresponds to such short exact sequence. And the automorphism group is just automorphism of E1, E3, E2, which preserves these arrows. And on this stack, we have natural map from, there are three natural maps, that is from EXX to of X, EI, that is sending E dot to EI. So now let's define the product on this cube vector space. It is defined in the following way. Let's take UI to be the element in this cube vector space. I go 1, 2. So if we are given this two element, we can construct diagram like, so as I described here, there are three maps, P1, P2, P3. We have a map P1, P2, to cof x, product cof x. And we have another map from here to X given by P3. And if the input is here, then we have this map Y1 product Y2 to cof X product cof X given by just row 1 and row 2. And yes, roughly speaking, the fiber of this map is something like X to 1 of two sheaves. I mean, so the product, yes. The fiber is, if you are given E1 and E2, the fiber is something like the extension class of E3 up to some isomorphisms. So, of course, well, in our situation, X to 1 is always finite dimensional. So this is finite type morphism. So this means that if you take the fiber product of this map, then this is also of finite type. And we can take its composition. So let's write it as row 3. So then using this diagram, define U1 star U2 to be that composition. Thank you. It's a kind of universal extension. Yes, it's a yes, the fiber is something like universal extension. Yes. And yes, indeed it is. Yeah, it is shown that yes. Indeed, so this definition is motivated by classical definition of the ring game Hopf algebra, which appeared in representation theory, and later this kind of product structure was later studied by Dominic Joyce or Bertrand Tohen. Yes. This is low one and this is P1. So it's, I'm sorry. Anyway, so this pair that HX. So this is associative algebra. With unit given by just object which sends point to this stack, which corresponds to the zero object. Well, this is, I think, Joyce, when, well, maybe other people. Yes, for example, yes, as asked, right, this is something like universal extension, so maybe, but it is also important to know about the automatism because we are thinking about everything is defined over stacks. So let's take E1 and E2 of X. So if we are given these objects, we have natural element of metric Hopf algebra that is just sending point to EI. So from this definition, I think it is a easy exercise, but this is given by like this. So the set of closed point of the fiber is given by X1 is E1 because it is parameterized by this extension class. But if we also consider the contribution from automatism, then it is given by the stack like this. So this is a vector space which acts on here in the trivial way. And this is a quotient stack like this. And so this map is given by sending element over here. Object in Xi. So this in Xi is nothing but the object which is given by this extension class that is. So this is the definition of the metric Hopf algebra. And So another property of this algebra is that there is a natural notion of the Poincaré polynomial. This is something like ratio of the Poincaré polynomials. That is what we call the following. So let's recall that if Y is quasi projective by T, then its compactly supported singular cohomology admits a mixed Hodge structure. And this virtual Poincaré polynomial is nothing but the weight polynomial of this mixed Hodge structure. That is, let's write PQY. Minus ij, minus I, dimension of W. So by the definition of mixed Hodge structure, so there is two kinds of filtrations, that is called weight filtration and Hodge filtrations, and at each associated group of the weight filtration, we have the pure Hodge structure on it. And we take the associated group of the mixed Hodge structure. And it's take its weight. So this is a polynomial in Q1 over 2. Well, this is nothing but the usual Poincaré polynomial if Y is smooth and projective. So this is I dimension of PIY I if Y is smooth projective. And the relationship of this virtual Poincaré polynomial and the Euler number is that, well, of course, if you take Q1 over 2 to be just 1, then you get the Euler number. And similarly, in the general case, this is true. That is, by taking a specialization of this polynomial, we can recover the Euler number. That is. I think this is J. Yes. Yeah. Half. Yeah, so this is something like a convention. Well, Q is about the Poincaré polynomial of like A1. And people write, something like Momotif of F, so yeah. Yeah, this is just a normalization. And, yes, the limit of Q2 to 1 of this Poincaré polynomial is nothing but the logical Euler number. Yes. As I told, well, the usual Donaldson-Thomas invariant is something like the topological Euler number of the moduli space. So as I told, we cannot define the Euler number of the moduli stack, but instead, it makes sense about talking about Poincaré polynomial. That is, this is due to the following fact by Kresh. So in the definition of the Motique Hov algebra, I assumed that the source stack Y has only affine geometric stabilizers, And assuming this condition implies some geometric consequence, that is, well, if I have element of this motric whole algebra, then there is a finite perturbation by like this, like the quotient stack. So these are quasi-projective variety. And which admits the action of G of N, and this is finite stratification. Yes, yeah, indeed. Well, if you have just stack, algebraic stack, which has only affine geometric stabilizers, then it is always between this way. So in this statement, where this map does, yeah, is not very important. So, as I thought, well, the order number of y does not make sense because the order number of the denominator may be zero, but still we may define like PQY to be the sum of the quotient of PQY I and PQ GFNC I. So this is a rational function in Q half. And indeed, well, it can be shown that this is well defined. That is independent of the choice of such stratification. So now under this preparation, I can define the so-called generalized DT invariant. So, again, let's consider the moduli stack of semi-stable sieves. Then, the moduli stacks of semi-stable sieves, this is an open substack of the stack of the sieves. And it is well known that this is of a finite type. So, the moduli stack of semi-stable sieves naturally gives an element of the motivic whole algebra. And, but, yes, we can apply this map PQ to this element and can define something like Poincaré polynomial of the moduli stack. But its limit to Q half to 1 does not make sense. But instead here, we can define the logarithm which I told before. That is epsilon V. So this is thought to be the logarithm of this moduli stack. So this is defined in the following way. This is the sum over all of F and V1 plus 2 VF equal V and PVI M equals to PVM. So these are the reduced Hilbert polynomials. And take the sum like this. Yes, indeed, it can be shown that this is a finite sum. Yes. I say that this is a logarithm of this modular stack because formally speaking, this is written as like if you take F V P V M equals to the fixed polynomial PM delta omega V equals to the log of 1 plus sigma of P V M equals to P V. Equals to delta. So yes, indeed this formula makes sense as a certain compression of the motivic over algebra. Yes, fix up. Yes, fix P. Yeah, sorry, P M. So this definition implies that if there is no strict semi-stable shift, that is M omega SSV equals to M omega V, then delta and epsilon are same. V equals to M omega SSV. Yes. Yes. So far, this is not related. So I will delete it later. Yes. Yes. Yeah, product star, yeah. So this is the LM on definition due to choice and so on. The claim is that where we also have to take the contribution from the Bernoulli function. So yeah, this operation I will explain later. So this operation makes sense, and this is called the generalized Thomas invariant. So yes, now I will explain about what is this operation. So this is not just take the rearrangement of the stack using the parent function. Theorem is that this one, this one exists. There's no pole. Yeah, I got it. Yes, this is the absence of pole. So I think this is the most difficult and very deep result in the theory of wall crossing argument of Donaldson-Thomas invariant. Yes, so this new dot operation is that. This is sending x to m. And so the Bernoulli function was a map from here to here, and I new inverse M2 of X. Because this is finite type, this operation makes sense. And so this is something like take the weighted Poincaré polynomial of this logarithm of this modular stack. And this is something like take the Euler number of that weighted Poincaré polynomial. And this Q minus one factor is, so this is just a trivial reason, because well, at any, every stack, there is trivial automatism coming from just C star. And this is nothing but cancel out the contribution of the C star automatism. And indeed, yes, this definition is compatible with the previous definition. That is, if there is no strictly semi-stable shifts, then this definition coincides with the integration of the parent function with major Euler number. Indeed, as I described here, if there is no strict semi-stable shift, then you can replace epsilon by delta, and by applying multiplication by Q minus one, you can cancel out the C-star automatism and make it just a scheme. And this is just taking the weighted Poincaré polynomial and taking the limit to taking the Euler number of that weighted Poincaré polynomial. That is nothing but the weighted Euler number. And yes. So here's some example. So for example, let's take the local Calabi-Yau effort given by the by this ranked vector space, which appeared before. And let S to be the zero section. And let C to be the image of the zero section. And if we take V to be the n multiplied by the Chan character of C, then in this case, it's not difficult to compute this generated Donaldson-Thomas invariant using from the definition. In that case, the modular stacks are just given by 1 point over GLNC, and this 1 point is given by corresponds to OC plus N. And in that case, it is, you can see that DT omega N charm multiplied of OC is given by 1 over N square. So indeed, so this is not integer in this case. So, and yes, in the beginning of this lecture, I talked about the product expansions of the generating series of stable pair invariants. And it decomposes into the series of large N invariants and large L invariants. And large N invariants should be defined exactly using this definition. Indeed, so this is also, this kind, so this is also counting one-dimensional semi-stable shifts on this Calabi-Yau effort. And this kind of invariant now appears in the wave crossing argument in the derived category. So today, that's it. Thank you very much.